It's not the duration, long duration of life that is important. It's the quality of one's life that makes the difference. Some people confuse life after death with it mere existence. I will always exist. But the people in hell always exist. So it's the quality of eternal life that makes life what it is in heaven. As we become Christians, then we are starting on the road to cultivating a new way of life. We are new creatures in Christ Jesus. We have been raised to walk in newness of life. Our goals should be different if they were set beforehand, simply and only in this life. Everything changes about our outlook. That's the whole meaning of being converted to Christ. One of the things that a person must learn to do is accept oneself. Now, a whole lot of folks who really don't want to accept what they are. And I don't mean doing evil and not changing when you ought to. I just mean what you are, what you're capable of doing. Now, Ken's been doing some studying, and while I was ill, I was able to watch part of it on the internet, on the talents in particular. But they had to come to the reality, that is, the people who received the different talents of the reality of their situation. Then they had to understand that it's in the reality of my given situation that I do what it is that God has obligated me to do. So we must accept also that different people have different talents and different degrees of ability. That must be understood, because really, as Ken's brought out so well in Matthew 25 and through that whole chapter, which is a judgment chapter, I think, in verses 14 through 30 now, that's being made very clear. People ask sometimes, well, what will be done at the judgment? Well, we know the New Testament is the standard of judgment for everyone that lives in the Christian age. We understand that. What do you do about the people with the different abilities? And they, being sane and sober, accept the reality of what they are. Well, we have different opportunities. We have different educations. All those things can be used to serve Christ. No two people are exactly alike. So if I'm going to be a one-talent man, because that's what I am, well, I could even be a half-talent man or a quarter of a talent man. Point is not the amount of talents. It's just be what you are by knowing what you are, which is accepting your reality. You won't do that too well by looking at somebody else. Oh, they're a good example. As they put into practice the truth in their own lives, can motivate you, but you can't be them. There's no use trying. You know, I've heard this several times. We're so far removed from when it actually happened. But the N.B. Hardeman meetings in the old Ryman Auditorium in Nashville that started, I think, in 1922 or 3, and ran all the way up to about 1940 or 42, somewhere along there, over a period of years, were some of the largest attending gospel meetings that's ever been held by members of the Church of Christ. They were broadcast, they were taken down, and the whole sermons were printed the next day in the Nashville newspaper, whichever one it was at that time. But when they were published, about five volumes, is that right, John, about five volumes? When you went to Fried Hardeman and other places, then Brother Hardeman was such a powerhouse in his knowledge of the Bible and his ability. So I'm told, and in reading after him, I certainly can see that. And I was told plainly that one of the reasons he was so great is that he was a genius, yet he was also had common sense. And a lot of his sayings he picked up off the streets of Henderson, listening to the fellows whittling on the street and talking to one another. He employed all that stuff in his teaching of the Bible. But he had such a power over young preachers. They told about one boy preaching on Sunday appointment up in Kentucky, a little house that probably more than 30 people in it. And he got so enthralled in preaching Brother Hardiman's sermon that at the invitation, he was inviting them to come down from the balconies to respond to the gospel invitation. Of course, there wasn't a balcony, and this thing wouldn't probably hold 30, 40 people. Now, that's really good in a lot of ways. Things he should have learned a little bit better about that, and I'm sure he did. But that shows you the impact of another person who may have far more talent than you do on you to get you to use what you've got. That's my concern with me personally, is accepting the reality about myself. It doesn't do any good, and we don't profit to grumble and complain about what nature didn't give us. You won't get the benefit of what he did give us if you do that. If we don't use, and this is the key, if we do not use and develop what we have, then we would not have used superior qualities if they hadn't been bestowed, or if they had been bestowed upon us. Somebody said, well, if I was a multimillionaire, I would do this and I would do that. You would do with multi-millions of dollars what you would do with $1 as far as the buying power is concerned. Now, that's taught in the Bible, because in Luke 16 in verse 10, he that is faithful in a very little is also faithful in much. And he that is unrighteous in very little is unrighteous also in much. So I think the best thing you can do and I can do, if we would become more like Christ, benefit from the study of the Bible, is to realize just the reality about ourselves and use what we have. Don't look around anybody else except to follow the example of another dedicated person doing the best they can with what they have to do with. But I do know this, if you don't use it, you'll lose it. I know that for an absolute fact. And God says, whatever you have, use it. Wherever you are, use it. Whatever opportunities you have, use it. On that basis, we'll be judged in the light of the standard of truth that is the New Testament. That's why it will be worse on people going to hell who lived in the United States than maybe people who were born and raised and died in China and lost. For with far greater opportunity comes far greater responsibility. And we have been born with, Kim was talking about, what was that, 75 pounds of silver is what a talent is? Is that what you're saying? Well, compare yourself, and his buddy likes to say, contrast yourself with everybody else in the world. Folks, we were born with silver spoons, gold spoons, diamond spoons, and everything else in our mouth when you compare and contrast us with the rest of the world. So accepting the reality of just being born in the United States and where I am with what I have and the opportunities that are available to me, look what a difference that makes in what we do, the other people just hope to do. Man's unwillingness to accept the inferior in life often prevents his reaching a higher goal than he really claims he wants. Everybody's heard of Daniel Webster. At least I think most people have. Maybe those below 40, and I'll be kind about that. Maybe you haven't. But Daniel Webster was a great senator. And he was a great orator. And he wanted to be president of the United States. And twice he was offered the vice presidency. And twice he turned it down. And yet both times, if he had accepted it due to the death of the president, he would have become president. You know, rising to things that we would like to be sometimes mean taking a step down. Jesus teaches that so plainly. He that would be greatest among you, let him be your servant. So a refusal to accept second place often keeps us from rising to first place. And I suppose that's a pretty good definition of conceit. It can be one of our most devastating enemies. Who, me? Accept that. Well, who are you? And that goes back then to accepting the reality of myself. You can see it in Paul's attitude when he described his life as chief of sinners, and if God could forgive me, he'd forgive anybody. So we're reminded of Proverbs 16:18. Pride goeth before destruction, and a haughty spirit before a fall. Another thing that's interesting, and I call these little things that are very big, if one were growing to develop as a Christian. We should be content with what we have, but not with what we are. Sometimes I think we confuse the two. Paul said, I have learned. And I've always read that and said, now Paul, as great as he was, could say, I have learned this. Something he didn't know, but I learned it. Then what does that say about me? He said, in whatsoever state I am, therein to be content. If you read the rest of that, he talks about being elevated highly in situations and low in situations. Philippians 4:11. But he never was content with himself. He stated in that same Philippian epistle to brethren who were very precious to him, because they stood by him in so many ways and supported him through so much. In verses 13 and 14, a familiar passage. Brethren, I count myself yet not to have laid hold, but one thing I do, this one thing I do, forgetting the things which are behind. Now I want to stop right there. Forgetting the things which are behind. Now he doesn't mean there that you can erase some things from your memory like it never happened. Age will do some of that. And we may need helps to jog our memory. That's not what he means. He's simply saying those things that I did that were wrong, I can't go back and change those. He's not talking about repentance either. You just can't go back and change some things. You can repent of it, but Paul couldn't bring Stephen back to life. Yet he gave his vote against him and held the clothes of those that stoned him. But when he says forgetting those things which are behind, what can I do for myself to make me a better person, as the Bible defines a better Christian? By harboring and mulling over those particular, we would call them today, negative thoughts. I can't do a thing about that. I just can't do it. But he did say, stretching forward to the things which are before, I press toward the goal unto the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. We can do that. But that means that we've got to recognize, what do I do with yesterday and the mistakes that I made? Well, recognize there are always mistakes, but resolve not to commit them again. I guess we can say, learn from your mistakes. And you probably won't commit as many if you learn from your mistakes. The other thing is to accept the reality of the fact that you're going to make mistakes. Anybody that strives to serve God as the Bible directs us in being faithful in service to God as a member of the Lord's church, you're going to make mistakes. Remember, everything God enjoins upon you to be faithful to Him as a member of His church is something you can develop and get better at. So when we worship this afternoon in this assembly, then maybe some of us have been worshiping for 50 years. Well, you're doing the same thing, aren't you? If you worship God acceptably in the first day of the week, Lord's Day Assembly, aren't we doing the same thing? That takes singing, aren't we singing? Some of these songs, some of us have sung all our life. But because of growing and developing, getting insights, hopefully becoming more wise, having a deeper knowledge of the Bible, a deeper understanding of other people, of growing in our own families, you have different thoughts cross your mind when you sing certain songs. Or when you're praying, pray a lot of the same. You know, model prayer hasn't changed in 2,000 years, as far as I know. It's still there to guide us. Well, model prayer works to guide the fellow that's been praying for 50 years as much as it does the one that just rose from water to the grave of baptism. Again, you lose it if you don't use it. So you're going to benefit and have insights and understanding you'll never get unless you use it. Just the way God made things. Same thing's true of Bible study and so on. In accepting ourselves, and this ties back in really with one earlier, I have to accept, I use a word people don't like to use anymore. I have to accept, and we have to accept, and I'll say we and emphasize we here, our handicaps. We are reminded of Noah, not the Noah of the Bible, but this is a fiction, work of fiction, in green pastures. And he said, and I quote, "I ain't very much, but I's all I got." I want you to think about that for a minute when it comes to you and your personal service to God. I'm all I've got. So when you think of these other things we're talking about and many others that pertain to being a faithful member of the Lord's church, then you got to work with what you got. And Eric, you're all you got. And David Brown, I'm all I've got. And you can put your name in there, so can everybody else. That's what I got to work with. But in looking at the miraculous gifts bestowed upon the early church in its infant stage of the laying on of the apostles' hands, you'll see that it's God that determined which gift a person got when an apostle laid hands on him. The apostle didn't do it. It was the Holy Spirit that determined whether you would get the gift of speaking in all these languages without having to study them, or whether you had the gift of prophecy. That's always interested me, God's insights into that person to say, this is the gift that fits you. And those gifts are always under your will. You could use them or not use them. You could abuse them, which is obvious that they did at Corinth and took a letter from the Holy Spirit to teach them how to use them and guide them. But then when you bring it over into normal conditions in the church among the members, you're able to see that each one of us then, and this ties again in with Ken's lessons on Sunday morning, on talents. Talent meant money then, but we use the word talent now to mean natural ability usually. You have to hone those and cultivate them. You know, when we quote the scripture, train up a child in the way he should go, and people misquote it and say, if you'll do it like you're supposed to, he'll become a Christian and never sin, never fall away. There is no passage of scripture that teaches the impossibility of apostasy. What is being taught there is that parents ought to distinguish between the differences in their own children's aptitudes, dispositions, and not try to force them into something. Well, let's just use something common. How many fathers are going to make their children play Little League baseball, whether they want to or not? They're going to have them do it because they're going to become that professional player. Well, what if the kid has a desire and a natural ability to play a piano?
Oh, I wish I could play a piano. I have the very idea of it.
Well, that's your own problem with your own self. That's going to mess up your own family. Wisdom says that you understand the difference in the kids. You understand which way, that's the Hebrew in that says the bend of the child. Has nothing directly to do with forgiveness of sins, though it could certainly have a background fundamental foundation in it. What he's saying is that he'll not depart from it. If you learn him as he is, because you're a father and you're supposed to have enough sense to do that. By the way, that means you've got to take a lot of time with them. Then you'll learn to see the differences in those kids. They can be all alike and yet completely unlike. And so you channel them according to their abilities, natural abilities, and they will use that, and when they're old, they will depart from it. You know, the Army's, maybe all the military, but I think the Army right now is tremendous in determining your aptitude. And they long, long ago gave aptitude tests. Are you more apt to go toward being a cook or something to do with electronics or something to do with carpentry or whatever? And they give you these tests and your aptitude is toward this. They try to channel you that way. Well, who better to give aptitude tests than father and mother? So this idea of understanding a child and then us understanding ourselves in the great family of God as we're brothers and sisters in Christ, does not make a difference? It should. The Bible says it should. Common sense says it should. We have to accept our limitations. One problem on that goes back to the matter of reality. We don't want to admit we have limitations. Oh, limit? Well, I can do anything. Well, you can't either. If you can do anything, one thing you've learned to do is lie by making that statement. That's not a good thing. So there are diversities of gifts, whether they were spiritual gifts in a miraculous way in the early church or what we're born with, we say naturally. Romans 12:4 said they're all of the same office. All the members have not the same office. Well, after accepting self, then we must accept obstacles as stepping stones. Anybody ever heard of Fanny J. Crosby? Well, if you've sung a lot of songs in our songbooks, you have, because she wrote no telling how many. I wouldn't begin to guess how many she wrote. But she was blind from the age of 6 weeks on. And here's what she said. She said, I am the happiest soul living. If I had not been deprived of my sight, I would never have received so good an education, nor cultivated so fine a memory, nor have been able to do good to so many people. She took a handicap and made it a stepping stone. Now, folks, if we as members of the Church of our Lord, children of God, the elect of the earth, if we can't learn to do that, why do we think we're anywhere near what we ought to be as a Christian? This self-acceptance of encumbrances was much better than useless resentment. Why couldn't my father and mother have been this way? Why couldn't my brother or sister have treated me this way? Why couldn't? Accept reality. Work with what you got. Don't let those things haunt you. You know, a lot, we'll say, you know, I don't believe in ghosts. I don't believe in haunted houses. Some of us have a backpack we should call our haunted house because we've got ghosts we bring with us from our childhood. And from various things, most of the time from our childhood. Well, you're the one to take that backpack off. You're the one to recognize what it is. And you know, if I can recognize that something is a problem to me that started back because the way someone did whatever to me, then if I can recognize that much, I can recognize that I have the power to put that thing back in a box and put it in the bed and forget about it. And that's where Paul's talking about forgetting those things which are behind. So Fanny Crosby could have gone to the streets to beg, but she chose to turn her adversity, blindness for 6 weeks old, into victory, and we sing so many of her songs today. Well, this is the lesson this afternoon. Do you think it's enough to keep us working on some things? Do you think it's enough to show what it means to seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness? And all these things should be added unto you. Do you think these little things that are intellectually easily understood can challenge us to the rest of the week, the rest of the month, and the rest of our lives? You know, these things have been being preached as long as I can remember. I know any faithful Christian, because all from the Bible have been preached since they were on earth to preach. So I know that there's something that we can go on and on and on to go into the depths of the mine and keep mining the gems that are there. That's just the way life is. And I'm talking about you who are members of the Lord's church and want to go to heaven. Well, here's the way you go to heaven. First of all, you got to accept you. Do you do that? Do you really have a view of yourself that is real? Do you really want people to think of you as special as you think you are? Well, just things, whatever we can say to make us step back and take a look. I'll close with this illustration. I remember going shopping with Mama. Mama could shop forever and never buy anything. She dragged me along with her because before my sister was born. And we would stand. I remember Mama standing there, me wore out, and she would be trying on. A lot of times she'd be trying stuff on me. But you remember these mirrors, how you stand and you see what's right in front of you. That's the way most of the time we look at the mirror. But when you're dressing, you know, you got these full-length mirrors and they got side mirrors. Have you ever caught yourself looking in the mirror and then this person you've never seen before catches your glance and you look that way? Because you don't look at yourself from beside yourself. You just don't. It's just like this. This is as good as I can think of. Do you remember the first time you heard yourself on tape? Well, that's where everybody else hears you. Because see, when I hear myself right now, it's in here. And that's the reason people think, do I sound like that? Well, that's the way we are before everybody else. I have my own sound in my own head of my voice. But that's not the way it sounds out there. So what about my own perception of the reality of myself? Sometimes it can sort of be like the first time I heard myself recorded, or I'm looking in the mirror and here's somebody over here. I try to look at him. It's that same fellow that's looking at me when I turn. But you kind of turn your eyes and catch a sight of yourself over here and say, ooh, double chin, I didn't like it. So you see, it's not so easy sometimes to see yourself and face the reality as the whole of just what we are. And I think that's a challenge to all of us. But that's where it begins. And that's where we'll work on it all our lives when it comes to our spiritual inward man. Now, closing with this one verse. Whoso looketh into the perfect law of liberty, he being not a forgetful hearer, but a doer of the work, this man shall be blessed in his deed. Have you looked at the verses preceding that? And it talks about a man who looks in a glass and seeth what manner of man he is and goes straightway and doesn't do anything about it. So you see, my little illustration was anticipated by God a long time ago to teach us about ourselves. Well, if you're not a Christian, you have now, and that's all you've got, and that's the reality of it. And you need to take advantage of it and use the opportunity to believe that Christ is the Son of God, repent of your sins, confess your faith in him, Son of God, and to be baptized to Christ for the remission of sins. Now, as a child of God, has this lesson helped you hear yourself as other people hear you? Or see this side picture in the panel of the mirror over here? If not, maybe you'll try to do that, but maybe you have seen something in your life that's contrary to God's will that you know that Christians shouldn't do. Well, God wants you to be still his faithful child of God, and you can by repenting of those sins, confessing them, and praying God for forgiveness. So take advantage of the reality of this song of invitation and respond to Jesus while we stand and sing. All right.